So welcome, Paul, from Cynthia's Periscope to John Doyle Band in conversation with, because it's in conversation with Cynthia's Periscope, I guess, tonight, and many other things as well we will get to as well, such as Tilted Fiction promotions and Tilted Audio, but that's exciting trailers for what's to come. So welcome, Paul.
Thanks for having me.
So, where shall we start with you? Let's see. Obviously, you're based in Manchester. Have you always been Manchester, or do you come from other realms?
I'm from Aberdeen, but I've lived in Manchester for like 10 years.
So why did you decide to move to Manchester then?
For the music scene, mainly, really. It's quite different in that respect. I mean, Aberdeen has got... it's got a good music scene, but I just think the larger population, the more kind of diversity and more variety you can have in a music scene, really, rather than just a few venues. It's, you know, 30 venues, so it's off with that.
So tell us all about how Cynthia's Periscope began and that sort of thing.
I think when it began, my influences were coming from, I was going to watch a lot of sort of experimental nights, some stuff that was kind of described as like harsh noise or experimental sound and very sort of formless kind of music, and I would enjoy parts of it, but I also enjoy a lot of pop, a lot of 80s synth pop, a lot of like even sort of stuff which is kind of like alt rock and stuff like that, and I just wanted to take some little bits of the experimental stuff and sort of push it into a form which is a bit more palatable, really.
But you also combine some of those, I guess, more performance art aspects of maybe those scenes as well. So when did you first start writing as Cynthia's Periscope, and were you in any projects before that?
There's a bit of a weird overlap where the last band I was in disbanded and about 4 years ago now, and before that I was in numerous bands for about over a decade, and I didn't have the name Cynthia's Periscope until about 2014, 2015, but I was writing lots of solo stuff under different names for about 5 years at least before that. So I've kind of decided everything that I've done on my own, most of my class is Cynthia's Periscope. So what I've done over the last few months is done some remastered EPs of old stuff which I had under various,
which obviously makes sense if it's stuff that you've written, then definitely an idea. So we should probably also ask why the name Cynthia's Periscope. Where does that come from?
That comes from when I was like a sort of young child in sort of early primary years, I would go to my neighbor's, who's like my childminder. She was called Cynthia, and she had this video game which you kind of put over your eyes. It was a bit like
it sounds a bit like it's a Tomytronic 3D game. Sort of shaped like a shield sort of thing with a like white rectangle on top, perhaps?
It was like you were in a tank and you'd fire missiles at these
things. I had that. It was red, wasn't it?
Yeah, I had
that. I played that to death.
I was quite obsessed with that game for like a couple of years, and I don't know why, it just seemed like I would drift into that. So maybe it's just a bit of the name of the act is maybe about escapism. And years later, someone pointed out that Cynthia sounds a bit like synth, and I thought, okay, well, that's also a nice kind of accident as well.
so. So that's kind of handy. So what are the basic philosophies then to your approach to creativity in music?
It varies over time, really. I mean, over lockdown, I've not really done much lyric writing, so I've just been quite enjoying writing instrumental stuff in various sort of genres. But before that, the real kind of ham on rye, kind of simple thing, what Cynthia's first, the real core of it is just lyrics to kind of music, really. So it'd often just be an event or something would happen that would just trigger a couple, like, you know, a couple lines of lyrics, and I'd have like a batch of instrumental synth tracks, and I'd kind of marry the two and go, okay, that one's kind of a bit angry, this synth track's a bit angry, this one's a bit, you know, more upbeat, this is an upbeat idea, and I just kind of merge things like that. It does just feel like I don't really sit and go, right, I'll write a song today. It's more like I have a load of instrumentals and I have a load of lyrical ideas, and then every so often I'll merge the two, and through that process it often becomes something different from what I had in mind for either of them. Like, I might be writing the lyrics thinking this should be a really fast tempo, aggressive sort of thing, and then I'll have a synth idea of, oh, okay, the lyrics should be really shouty for this, and then I'll put the two together and it'll end up being really melancholy and slow.
So to some extent, when you're writing, even you don't know what's going to happen.
That makes it sound more exciting than it is, but yeah,
look, we've got to make it exciting. That, because you are exciting, I have always enjoyed your live performance, as you don't.
There's a kink in my soul, but I claim it's not my fault. And I'm sorry I can't attend today. There's an existential crisis, and it's born of a focus. The appointment was due between 4 and 8. If I anticipate disappointments, at least my expectations will be met. The letter arrived after the allocated time. When I get the chance, I'll add it to my list of modern complaints. Incantiety stands on a pillar of salt. Incantiety to your intelligence, an insult. Incantiety stands on a pillar of salt.
With your performance, you tend to throw in things that are unexpected and unusual, definitely incorporating unusual instruments. And while I couldn't find, say, an oil-filled one, I've got a heater for you, you know. So what inspired picking up an oil-filled radiator to start playing on stage?
Is that
your most treasured musical instrument?
I think that's... I've just in my rehearsal room, and it was cold, and I bought one of them because it was cold, and I thought, okay, I'm going to start doing some percussion, and I used to play with like a cymbal as well,
yeah,
and a couple of little things, and then those sort of didn't really last the test of time, and that did, and I've played gigs where I'll look for objects in the venue and play them, but that's sometimes that works and sometimes it doesn't, because I'll spot like a fire extinguisher at the far end of the venue. I think, right, well, I have to get over there and back in the bridge, and I've only got 16 bars to do that, so I'll have to run through the crowd for 4 bars, hit it for 4 bars, run back for 4 bars, then maybe take a swig of water, and then I can do the final chorus.
Well, it's interesting to throw in such a challenge to the music anyway, I think. Definitely a different approach. And also, when you played Sheffield for me, and you certainly broke the boundaries of stage performance, I think, by possibly even leaving the auditorium. When you got your paddle thing out, which you were hitting in a percussive manner, which is an awfully good and strangely intimidating aspect. I mean, do you enjoy that intimidation aspect? Because you are sometimes quite scary on stage.
I did have one gig, and I can't remember what the town was called. It was a town near Blackburn, and it was like a sort of social club event. And at the end of the gig, they had the projector on a little stage, and I tried to walk on the little stage, and it broke. And
Oops.
but I was totally unintentional. And then a part of the actual stage fell apart, and it seemed like to the audience that I was intentionally destroying things. And then at the end of the gig, I did the thing with the table tennis bat, and I accidentally knocked over someone's pint. So this is just like a series of mishaps. And someone afterwards was like, "You're so punk," and I was like, "No, I'm just really clumsy." And so
I get that too. Oh my God, you're so wild, punk, and crazy. Well, no, I'm just totally incompetent, that's all.
I thought I'd be in a lot of trouble with this guy who knocked over his pint, and then he came up to me afterwards and went, "Excuse me," and I thought, "Oh God, I'm getting anyone, can I buy you a drink?" And I was like, "Oh, I think I need to buy you a drink though." So it was all fine in the end. I have a moment of panic that this burly guy was just gonna sort of pummel me to a pulp.
But there is definitely, I mean, the thing is, perhaps you can say that there's a punk idea to your musical approach in the sort of original ethos of punk of breaking down boundaries and such. I mean, are there any punk bands that have influenced you at all?
Well, a lot of my favorite punk bands aren't punk bands. They're all the ones that were kind of well, I like quite obvious sort of big names like Talking Heads and Blondie, Stranglers, Gang of Four. We mentioned Early Human League, and a lot of those bands were from that era, but they're not really punk. I do like the big names as well, but like, I find that most of the bands I like, which are described as punk, were maybe not punk in the pure sense of three chords and you go.
I'm stuck inside of this person. Everyone in the room, they clapped for me. But none of it was real as far as I could tell. No one in the room is laughing at you. You're framing the conversation to fit what you know. Down an avenue of misunderstanding is where we always end up.
What inspires the stage dress sense and so forth?
I find that as a solo act, you don't when you watch a band play, just the kind of the magic of watching people play together is, even if they're not particularly jumping around a lot or doing anything to really engage the crowd, the spectacle of kind of watching people be really in the groove together and really sort of creating that magic together is the performance. But if you're a solo act, especially an electronic solo act who relies a lot on backing tracks, you need to do something else, really.
You've got to
So
put on something.
that's kind of where that comes from, where this, and some of, I mean, part of it is sort of planned chaos, where like I have to plan out when I'll do certain things in the set. And I'd love to say that it was completely improvised, but
No.
there's bits where I will go, okay, I've got 16 bars here where I can turn different filters and stuff on the synth, and it'll be different every time slightly because it's not entirely repeatable. And there's bits where I'll go, okay, I'll go and do something for a bit of the song in the crowd. But because there's a backing track, you kind of need to know that that'll end and the next track will start. And yeah, so I think some of those things, like the kind of crowd engagement and stuff, is to just make it something where it's not just a person on stage performing, because otherwise then that's just like watching a person rehearse on their own. Whereas a band, you don't really... Okay, watching a band can be boring, but...
Well, I certainly think so sometimes, but, you know, that's just my opinion, you know, whatever.
But a band does have the advantage of just, like, four people together, even if it's not massively exciting, there is something about them clicking together which has a certain amount of kind of watchability. So some of the kind of antics and stuff are just to make it something that's rememberable, really, you know, just something that will stick out to people in some way.
And I think definitely, as I mentioned, for example, the Sheffield gig, I don't think people will forget that in a hurry. You certainly took people rather by storm there, I think, with a very, very impressive performance, which I absolutely loved, which is why I've asked you along to say the gig, where was it, Stoke, wasn't it?
The Stoke one, yeah, that was great, that one, yeah. That one felt like a bit like everyone was on our side from the get-go.
Yeah.
That's nice, but it's also kind of sometimes nice when there's definitely people there when, like, the one in London, for example, was like, there was the people there for the gig, and then there was the hardcore Arsenal fans.
Yeah, that was intriguing.
It was quite fun just watching some of the hardcore, you know, diehard Arsenal fans go to the Arsenal pub and see some quite strange electronic stuff on.
That was when I did the sort of protest gig. That's when I got married on stage, you know. It was Insurrectionary Near Futurism versus the Royal Wedding when Harry was getting married to Meghan. I mean, I've nothing specifically against Harry or Meghan, it's just the idea of famous people getting married, who it's such a marvellous deal. But, you know, I think it was a really exciting afternoon and evening, that, I think. And it was kind of fun in some ways that people had this habit, perhaps you could say, of getting up on stage unpredictable. But I don't know, sometimes I think some things like that can you carry on when that happens? What have you had many other experiences where things have been rather unpredictable for you, even?
Yeah, there was one gig in particular, which was in Rhyl in North Wales, and this was just a sort of comedy of errors, which kind of turned out okay in the end. But it was one of these gigs, I wouldn't want to repeat the experience, but it's quite a funny story, where it was like an experimental electronic night in quite a sort of, you know, standard sort of pub. Wasn't like a kind of bohemian venue. It was, you know, people go there for a pint. If the music's on, they'll pay a bit of attention to it, but they're not really too bothered. I went there, three acts were meant to be on, one of them pulled out, the other one, his equipment failed, so it was just me playing, and the pub was full of people that had just been to a funeral, and they were having the wake at the pub.
Yeah.
So I had to play to, like, a wake, basically, of people who are very drunk, and because they're very drunk, they seem to be quite on board with it, and I was anticipating it being a complete disaster. But I think because they were so drunk and they wanted to drown their sorrows that their friend or family member had died, that some of them ignored me, and a few of them got really into it. And then I finished playing, because I was the only act, they were like, have you got any more songs? So I basically played every song that I'd written in the past 6 years. So it just went on and on and on. And then it was just a really bizarre experience. And it was one of those things that was I felt really uncomfortable at the time, but afterwards it was quite funny.
Yeah. So is there a worst gig that you've done? A performance where things were perhaps unpleasant in, or things didn't really work, something was really wrong with the evening? Can you think of any?
That's probably the one that comes to mind. but that one's kind of funny. There's been some ones which aren't, I think ones that go like that, which are so kind of farcical it becomes funny, are okay. But ones that are just underwhelming are kind of worse. So I think that one I just described though probably would cover that, because I could think of somewhere go, oh, okay, well, the sound wasn't great, or this wasn't great, or I messed up the lyrics or something. But those ones are just like kind of middle of the road. The playing to Wake, I think, was just
Certainly a wedding. So Cynthia's Periscope, available for weddings, bar mitzvahs, and funerals.
No, just funerals.
Oh right, sorry. I wanna kiss Mercury and fill in Lazarus. All these boys with their big toys, just like the King Bullet with cardboard and a rips. I said all these boys with their big hearts. So, speaking of audio, that's something which is significant for you, because you both work as a live sound engineer, and of course you have your own sort of music production service of Tilted Audio. So tell us about your enthusiasm for audio then, and whatever you can think of in to do with that.
Well, yeah, I mean, like, over the last year, I still have been writing stuff, but I've kind of changed my focus a little bit, where prior to the pandemic, I was working in live venues and I'm studying and finished my course now. But I've actually done some like commissions for like songwriting sort of commissions recently, and that's been my main kind of focus for Tilted Audio the last few months. I done a few scores. I did a score for like a sort of sci-fi off the wall comedy short film.
That certainly sounds interesting.
I did lots of kind of John Williams style orchestral stuff on it, and then loads of like really kind of hard EDM sort of.
That sounds kind of a very unusual mix.
Yeah. So that was really good fun.
So tell us a bit. Can you tell us a bit more about that film? What's its name and so forth?
It was a sort of a short comedy, like a sci-fi. I don't know how to describe it. It was something like you know, Adult Swim.
Yeah, I get the idea. Yeah.
The sort of thing that would be on Adult Swim, like a kind of comedy for adults with sort of childish elements. Like it was sort of props that were blatantly on strings and stuff. And it was called Columpadumps. And it's going to be on YouTube and it's going to be released soon, but I've done a few of these commissions and I'll do my part, and then they go, okay, we'll let you know when it comes out in like 6 months time or a year's time. So once I do my bit, I kind of just have to wait till it's released.
Yeah.
So I've done a few things like that. So
have any of them been more tricky than others, and is there anything that we can sort of possibly include in this that's already out there?
Well, most of them, I only did the last few months, so like they're still not out yet, because I guess once I do my bit, there's still maybe more editing and stuff that needs to be done. I did another one where it was like a digital animator just did this sort of choreographed video with sort of like animatrons dancing, and they wanted some music for it, and I did a kind of really kind of sinister sort of electronica kind of track, which is more towards like the sort of Warp Records kind of creepy, weird, experimental sort of electronic stuff. That was great, but the thing that was difficult about that is matching what you play with the on-screen action.
Yeah.
Because they provided the animation, and it's not to a tempo, so I have to kind of get elements of the mix to jump out at points in time which aren't exactly on the start of a bar or the start of a chord progression or, you know, whatever. So yeah, that was quite interesting, just playing about with different things, and you can sometimes have to do tempo shifts and stuff to get it to really fit in as much as possible. And at some points you have to just eventually accept that it might be a few frames out, but if someone is on board with it when they're watching it, they won't notice that, because they'll just kind of go, oh, that happened at roughly the same time.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, if someone's slowed it down, they'll go, hang on a minute, that's not quite right, but, you know.
And I think as producers ourselves, we'd probably be more nitpicking of our own productions. I mean, we know every little thing in a live performance that goes wrong. I didn't quite hit that beat. And it's amazing how forgiving audiences can be, but I think probably the audience won't really notice anything. So also there's the Tilted Fiction promotions. So what makes you want to put on gigs then, like a madman like me?
Well, I've not really done that in a couple of years.
Yeah, but you have done it. I don't care whether you haven't done it in a couple of years. You have done it, so that's your...
Yeah, so when I was doing it, it was just trying to fill in something that I didn't really see was being filled in. And I wasn't terribly good at it, because I would just assume whatever I liked, people would like.
Same, yeah. I had that problem in the past, but, you know.
So I would often find that there would be, being a sound engineer doing live events, there would be, like again, saying about Cynthia's Periscope, there'd be stuff that'd be very experimental, very avant-garde, and then there'd be stuff that'd be very pop, or very rock, or very, you know, very sort of mainstream. And I just wanted to find something in between, and I came up with the name Tilted Fiction because there'd be a lot of experimental nights on called, like, weird or wonky or out there, and I thought, well, this is just a bit tilted, where it's
it's not totally skewed, it's just a little bit.
Yeah, so it was a bit of a kind of a little cheeky pun about, like, it's about stuff that's kind of different but not different, but still I would like to think got a lot of mass appeal, really. But like I say, my plan was to finish my course. I finished uni last year and then go straight back into promotion. But then with the lockdown, I thought about, I've not really, the idea of doing the sort of live stream events and stuff, there just seemed to be a lot of people already doing that better than I probably could. So I just sort of thought I'll pick it up again, maybe later on this year, next year, possibly. Yeah. A lot of people already doing that better than I probably could. So I just sort of thought I'll pick it up again, maybe later on this year, next year, possibly.
Yeah. And also, you're one of the many people I've talked to who gets involved in the electronic music open mic nights. So it's been quite the popular subject, it seems, in these interviews. But the thing is, they've been a great place to meet new, interesting people. So tell me of your experiences with the electronic music open mic nights.
Yeah, so I've had quite, you know, I think that from speaking to Martin, what he's aimed to create, he's done a very good job of, like, making it happen and constantly keeping sort of energy behind it and letting it expand to other places, you know, even outside of the UK. And I've had some, like I went to the one in Berlin. That was really like probably my favorite one to play because it was just a lot of the people there were literally from all around the world. And so there's been quite a few that have been really sort of enjoyable to play. And I think what he's done is really just given a really good starting point for a lot of people that maybe just kind of bedroom musicians, and then from there they'll kind of get really into playing live and just go on from there and there. And it feels like a good overlap between, there's the kind of people who do modular meetups and stuff like that, and then there's the kind of straightforward gigs, and it's a nice in between being a kind of meetup, look at the gear kind of event, and then a kind of straightforward gig.
And yeah, you never know quite what you're going to get exactly with such things. Yeah. So who in both the EMOM scene, if you want to call it that, and also in the live scene, have you been particularly enjoying, other than Jan Doyle Band, of course, who is everyone's favourite band, but who in the live scene do you think needs a particular attention?
There was someone in Berlin, the Berlin emo called Love Cats. It was really good. Also, a guy from the States who played one of the EMOMs, so I played a few gigs, we called Work. Well, it's him and his brother, actually, called Work. Work, spelt with a zero for an O.
Yes, they're very good indeed.
Yeah.
So I think we've about covered most things now. So perhaps first of all, anything you think I've maybe missed that you want to tell us?
Just maybe like a couple of things I've got coming up in the future. I've got for the next Bandcamp Friday, which is not tomorrow, but next week, I've got a...
Well, it wouldn't be tomorrow when this goes out anyway. This is probably going to take several days of editing. Well, actually, I don't think this would be too bad. But, you know.
So next Friday, Bandcamp Friday, I'll be releasing an EP of remastered early works, which is probably stuff that most people who've heard me won't have heard, stuff from 5 to 10 years ago. I've got that coming out, and then hopefully by following Bandcamp Friday, I'll have an EP of collaborations. So that's been, it's been in kind of in progress for a while. So I just need to kind of do a lot of mixing on it and stuff to get it ready. And other than that, I've just been doing little commission things here and there. That's about it really. And then after all that, I've got an album that was the stuff that I usually play live. And that's halfway finished. But at the start of lockdown, I kind of went off doing any more work on it because it's the things I do live, and I thought, well, I can't do that live, so why don't I just do a load of new things instead for a while?
Right, I won't keep you any longer then, but thank you very much for joining me tonight, and all being well, you'll be soaring to huge success now you've had this hugely popular interview series feature you. I mean, who knows, mate? Anyway, yes, thank you very much for joining me, and all the best for future projects then.
Thanks for having me, Derek. It's good to see you.
And let's play live again soon, because I always enjoy a live performance.
Definitely.
All right, when things are ready, let's do it.